Hello everybody and welcome to part three of my talk on, and this is covers therapy options. This is a fairly detailed or a longer talk. Now the way I'm going to present this is really in four parts. The first part will be to do with the essentials and understanding of what is called client-centered therapy and the communication and interpersonal skills that a therapist will need if they are to benefit their patients particularly well. I'll then go on to something like seven different therapy options. And the purpose of this is to really show that there are a large number of problem-solving methods which may be quite distinct from each other. And I intend to go through them. And these modalities are really CBT or cognitive behavior therapy, which is the mainstay of conventional medicine, and then something like six others which are outside medicine. And I'll be focusing on Buddhist psychotherapy, something called transpersonal psychotherapy. Then there's a modality of healing or Reiki. I'll then go on to clinical hypnotherapy. I will deal with what's called deep level hypnotherapy as a separate topic, and this covers topics like past life regression therapy. And last of all, I'm doing a talk on psychic readings. I'll then quickly go through like a summary of all of these in a very specific way. After that, I'll be dealing with what can be called commonalities. When I was preparing this talk on mental health, I discovered that there were a number of things that could be used in a beneficial way in any form of mental health therapy. And they were not particular to any one particular mode of operation. And so I'll briefly discuss things like meditation, mindfulness, diet and exercise, social prescribing, emotional intelligence, positive thinking, and the so-called law of attraction. I'll then go on to the Kubler-Ross model for particular reasons. And last of all, I'll deal with briefly on something called transactional analysis. Okay, let's start with client-centered therapy, or what is also called humanistic counseling. And this is based on the work of Carl Rogers, a psychologist from the United States who, 1902 to 1987, was considered the founder of modern counseling and possibly one of the most important figures in this field. Now, Carl Rogers said that for a client to benefit from a therapist, the therapist had to have four particular qualities that they had to, as it were, emanate. The first is empathy. Empathy is really, in this case, the ability to project the idea that one cares about somebody else. So, and this occurs even in, for example, it's not enough for the therapist to feel empathy for the client. The client has to experience that, feel that the therapist actually cares about them. So when the client sits in the therapist chair or something like this, they have to feel, does this therapist really care about me? So that's empathy. The second is positive unconditional regard. This is what one would expect of anybody that sits in front of a doctor. So you need to be able to feel free to be able to say whatever it is and not feel that the doctor or therapist is judging you. They are listening to you, and they can so no matter what you say, they can experience they you you the doctor or therapist looks at the deals with the matter in a professional way. And it is not enough for a therapist to feel that they have positive unconditional regard. The client needs to feel that they have this. The third is authenticity. Authenticity refers to the idea that one of being real, of being authentic. And in practice, this means not giving double messages. Like you can't say, "Oh, talk to me about this topic," but your body language suggests that you're not comfortable listening to them talking about it. And also, authentic means if you do not know about something, say suppose the client brings up a topic which the therapist does not know enough about, the therapist needs to be actually authentically say, "Look, I don't know enough about this." Interestingly enough, saying you don't know actually inspires confidence. But somebody who pretends they know something they don't does not inspire confidence in the long term. And the fourth quality is listening. Now, this may appear obvious, but the question is, does the client feel that the therapist is listening to what they have to say? Now, in this regard, you can look at listening as having three separate levels. Level one is the kind of listening that people have in everyday life, where everybody they interact with or they supposedly listens to them are actually reacting to them. So all the kind of experiences we have every day of talking to people are just people, other people reacting to us. And we reacting to them verbally, whatever. So even the people that love us and care for us, like our family, friends, and things like this, they still don't listen to us, they are reacting to us. So most people will hardly ever experience anything other than grade one listening in their lives. Grade two listening refers to being listened to without being interrupted to a large extent. And occasionally, if an ordinary person is going through a period of difficulty and they call up a friend, say, "Hey, let's meet in the pub or a bar, and I need to offload something." And this friend meets you and actually sits down and listens to what you have to say without interrupting you too much. So you can actually complete a whole paragraph or a whole sentence or a whole thing and feel that the other person is actually listening to what you have to say without them giving you immediately attempting to give you advice on the matter. So that is great to listening. Even that is fairly rare. Grade three listening is something that a therapist has to actually learn, practice doing. So, grade three listening is a condition in which the client feels that the therapist is really listening to them and can give them a period where they can say what they want and they are being listened to and not interrupted unnecessarily. They can have their say, as it were, in this full sense. And this is a hugely healing experience, surprisingly. So you do the most when you're doing nothing at all. But it is actually very hard to listen, and this is a skill that needs to be developed by a therapist, and this can take some doing. So these are the four criteria that Carl Rogers stated that a therapist would require. I have added four other things to deal with being a client-centered therapist that are very essential to becoming, to successfully doing the job. And one I would call a dustbin function. A lot of the benefit that a client gets from seeing a therapist is the ability to offload. And so the therapist has to see themselves as a giant dustbin, a great big dustbin, lined with Teflon and with a great big hole in the bottom. So all the negative stuff, all the stuff the client spews up, the therapist in the dustbin hoovers up and immediately lets out through the bottom. It's quite important for the therapist to have a dustbin function with a large hole at the bottom, because what a therapist does not want is to hold on to the client stuff. Because if they are not able to release all that stuff from themselves, they will make themselves ill very quickly. So that's critical. So for that reason, many therapists develop various self-care rituals. Within complementary therapy, between clients, many therapists will have particular rituals such as opening the windows, ringing bells, lighting a joss stick, or going around with burning sage with the room and saying prayers so that the previous client's negative energy doesn't stay in the room, it is dissipated, and the client themselves are not holding on to it. So this is quite important. In this regard, it comes to mind to I recall a story I heard, and this is a teaching story, which is, I think, attributed to Tolstoy. And in this story, it's the story of some kind of philosopher king who was looking for the secret of life or the secret of religion or something like this. And he came to the belief that all things boiled down to three points. The first point is, what is the right place? The second point, what is the right time? And the third thing is, what is the right thing to do? Well, you guessed it. The right place is right here. The right time is right now. And what is the most important thing to do? It is to care. So when you're with someone, as a therapist will be with a client, the requirement is to actually care for them, to care. But a lot of the time in our lives, we are by ourselves. And that's the time we have to focus on caring for ourselves. So the therapist has to focus on caring for himself or herself. And that's quite important. So you're caring at all times of the day. But when you're by yourself, you spend that time caring for yourself. And unless therapists can learn to successfully care for themselves, they will never survive being a therapist in the long term, or be able to really render much help to other people. And there's a lot of self-learning that is involved with this thing. Because of the nature of the process, therapists will often see their clients as a kind of spiritual teacher, because they will themselves need to learn lessons all the time. So it's an evolving process. So the therapist is also on their own personal learning curve. And also they will have to deal with their own, so to speak, shadow side. All people that work in the therapy business will come to things in themselves that they don't like, things that normally would be swept under the carpet and stuff like this. And they need to find ways to deal with that material and make sense of it and operate. And there's a lot of help available, and many therapists will find other therapists that specialize in this kind of work that they develop. And it's quite essential to do this. Now, it's quite important to understand that in client-centered therapy, the therapist is actually an innate ingredient in the healing and therapeutic process. This is why some therapists are very, very people. The difference between some people get a great deal of benefit from seeing one therapist rather than another therapist, because some therapists are really exude that quality of healing from themselves, and they're able to pass this on in some mysterious way to their clients. So they are an integral part of the healing process. And in this connection, it is quite important to describe the role of the idea of placebo. Placebo is really the there's now a huge amount of scientific research that has been done on the power of the mind and the power of the mind to heal and believe. And placebo, I mean, people have been, the headache improves often instantly if they take a paracetamol or an Advil or some kind of thing that they think is the thing, whereas actually it might be a dummy drug. So it's astonishing. There's a huge amount of material, documentaries and things on the power of placebo. So in this respect, remember that it's not a part of the healing process is a therapist who inspires confidence and inspires caring is itself 50% of often the cure that the client will benefit from. So that's about this. I'd just like to go through the basics of cognitive behavioral therapy, or CBT. Now, this is the gold standard and mainstay of problem solving and problems and management within conventional medicine and within that particular umbrella. There's a huge amount of information on the thing and extremely good information from various sources. So I will briefly deal with some of the main points. So the therapist will attempt to break the problems of the client down into situations, thoughts, emotions, physical feelings, and actions. I won't go into any of these because you can read about them from most books and how it's done. The second principle is the idea of breaking up large problems into several smaller ones. Now, generally, when people are in a state of severe stress or anxiety, a lot of their life problems from different areas, for example, they might have lost their job, but that impacts their relationship and that impacts their health. And often they completely collapse in a heap. And everything is compounded all together. So part of the therapist's work is to actually separate out different aspects of the problems into specific portions. This is wrong, that's wrong, and then you work on pragmatic. The approach is pragmatic. So focus on which problems are solvable. And there are some problems that are not immediately solvable or more long term, which you've got to, at least at the moment, the client is taught to live with. And essentially, the therapist will set very specific goals. Now, all this is very common sense, and many of these approaches share many things in common with Buddhist psychotherapy, which I will cover next. But it's worth mentioning it, and I've got a little chapter in my book on CBT. Now, on a practical level, the quality of services available to the general population can vary. So, although CBT is in theory the answer to things, the quality of CBT available either online or through therapists and things like this, when provided to very large numbers of people, such as in the National Health and things like this, the quality can vary. So it's and it's difficult to say because, I mean, you can get people that can have very high quality CBT help, and but if a therapist is struggling with too big a workload, then the ability to provide very good quality care is understandably less. Now, in connection with this, now within the context of conventional medicine, any issues to do with spirituality and personal growth are kind of avoided. Definitely avoided, actually. And but there are two things in current CBT that have been borrowed from the world of, or have become a mainstay, taken from the world of Buddhist psychotherapy. And one is called mindfulness-based CBT, and the other is mindfulness-based stress reduction, or MBSR. Okay, that's the bit I have to say about cognitive behavioral therapy, Buddhist psychotherapy. Now, this is a topic that excites me very much because I have actually spent much of my life reading about Buddhist ideas and attempting to follow them in my own personal life, and to what extent I am some kind of psychotherapist. The ideas that I'm about to describe form, to some extent, a lot of the basis of the advice I sometimes give to others if they should ask me. But here's the thing about Buddhist psychotherapy. I'm not going to go into too much of anything to do with the history of Buddhism, but essentially, for practical purposes, Buddhism is really about understanding the laws of life and the laws of mind, or how the mind works. Now, Buddhism has got no God in the sense of a Judeo-Christian type figure. There is no concept of utopia. And as far as the meaning of nirvana is concerned, in my opinion, nirvana refers to a state of peace of mind where one can retain a state of peace of mind in the midst of a nest of troubles. So that is what nirvana, I think, means. Now, it's a huge topic and I could speak about it all day. However, it is only a small chapter in this large talk, so I'll be very brief. Now, I've picked up about six or seven basic ideas from Buddhist, from what I've learned about Buddhist Buddhist psychotherapy, which I have set down here, which I will attempt to describe very, very briefly. Before going forward, I have to say that there is no governing authority that decides what Buddhist psychotherapy is. There is no central figure. There is no, even the Dalai Lama, as is a teacher of, is one of many teachers of Buddhism, and not, and there is no Pope, central authority, and many people are free to have their own ideas about what sense to make of them or apply them. Okay, let's look at the therapy bit of it. The first thing is the emphasis on making peace with the reality of your life. In fact, if I had to describe Buddhist psychotherapy in two words, it would be to make peace with a situation, with a thing, as opposed to attempting to change it. So, depression, anxiety, and stress are considered as integral parts of this earthly life experience, and as such, cannot be avoided. So they have to be taken as they are, and you've got to make peace with them, live with them, and allow them to do their thing and move on. Now, just to give you a rough idea of what it means to deal with the kind of reality of your life, Take this little example that I thought up. Now, assume that I'm sitting happily in my study doing something, and a letter comes through the door. And I go down, and it's a letter in a brown envelope from the Inland Revenue, and informing me that I have got a large tax bill to pay that I had not factored for and that I was not expecting. So, understandably, I'll go into a kind of a panic. Now, just imagine that as I'm going upstairs in a state of distress, there's a knock on the door, and I open the door, and there are three people standing there waiting to come in. One is Mr. Anxiety, Mr. Stress, and Mr. Depression, right? Now, I don't want them there in my house, so I can tell them to go away. Or I can welcome them in and tell them to make themselves comfortable. This is the choice I have. It's no good telling them to go away because they won't go away. They have the keys to your house and they will come in and make themselves comfortable irrespective of your wishes and ideas. Given that that's the case, you may as well invite them in, tell them to make themselves comfortable, tell them where the fridge is, where the liquor cabinet is or whatever is, and just go up and let them do their thing. So that's about making, so when bad things happen, the first step is to actually make peace with the fact. You expect it to happen and you make peace with it when it happens. And the thing is that if you do that, the actual duration of these bad times usually is shorter than it needs to be. So it's about making peace with a situation. The second bit is to define what a problem is. Now, a problem is something that has a solution. If something does not have a solution, it is not a problem. So, for example, if I'm trapped in a loveless marriage and I'm not willing to do anything about it, then it's not a problem because there's nothing I'm going to do about it. My only thing is to make peace with the situation. So if a client has a problem that they are not willing to, or they cannot or will not do anything about, then it is not a problem. So treat it as something they have to live with. The next thing is what is called the law of imperfection. And I like to think of it as the 7/10 rule. In life, you often look for 10 upon 10 situations, which actually do not exist, except in our fantasy. So the perfect job, the perfect partner, the perfect life may exist very briefly, but in general, nothing stays at 10 over 10 for very long. And so we need to have realistic expectations about anything and everything and accept 7/10 as the 10/10. So is your partner, spouse or whatever 7/10? If so, that's 10/10. Is your job 7/10? Then it's 10/10. Is your health 7/10? That's 10/10. So in all circumstances, keep expectations realistic, and look at and don't look at don't look for 10/10. The next thing is the idea of control versus adaptation. Now, perhaps 70% of our life is not actually in our control. 30% of it is. So, whether it be in our personal life, our work life, our health, different kinds of things, there's only so much we can do actually to control the situation. So the in Buddhism, the idea is not to become a control freak. It is actually to become an adaptation freak. So you're focused on constant adaptation, not on attempting to control something that you can't control. Because that is the you're going to fail at it if you try. The next point I'd like to bring is the idea of self-improvement. Many people are focused on the idea that they have to become better and better. Every day, little by little, I'm becoming better and better. Forget about that. The law of imperfection really states that nothing is going to be perfect, or if it is perfect, it's not for long. So the effort in Buddhist meditation and many spiritual practices is not to become a better person, but really to become more accepting of the imperfect person that we are. So as it were, progress in this area is not gauged by how whether you have become better, but whether you have become more accepting of yourself. So unless you can accept yourself as you are, warts and all, you cannot love yourself. And if you cannot love yourself, you will never love other people. So charity starts at home. So you have to be charitable with yourself before you can consider the idea of being charitable to others, or having that kind of view. The next I would say is the law of interdependence. Now everything is based upon everything else in Buddhism. No man is an island, and we know for a fact that when we are very young, when we are very old, or we are very ill, survival is not possible without the help of other people looking after us. So in all circumstances in life, we are actually interdependent on our surroundings, interdependent on our environment, dependent on other people. So Buddhist ideas tend to focus on family, community, groups and things like this. And it's about being able to give and also receive care and gratitude. So you have to be able to give and also to receive. So it's and we know for a fact, for all the studies have shown, that relationships are key to human happiness. And the last point I want to raise briefly is the idea of focusing on, so focus on one's successes, not on one's failures. One does not learn from one's failures, one learns from one's successes. So all of life is experimental and every day is experimental. If we focus on what has gone wrong, then we are on the wrong track. Expect stuff to go wrong, but look at what goes right and improve on that, or learn from that. So learn from your successes, forget about your failures. That covers most of the stuff on Buddhist psychotherapy in a nutshell. Before I move on to another topic, I really have to talk about two things that I feel this particular field of therapy has a great deal to offer. One is in relationships. Like a lot of marriages break down because people focus on the bad points of the other person, or what they perceive to be the bad points. In Buddhism, you focus, remember the 7 upon 10 rule. So is the person that you're with 7 out of 10? If they are, that is 10 out of 10. And so you're not, and there's an attempt to focus on what is good in the other person, not what is wrong with them. And if one can keep this attitude, life becomes much better, really, for all parties concerned. The other thing that I cannot pass over is the how Buddhist idea psychotherapy might deal with victim issues. Like people can feel victimized or feel that life has treated them unjustly for a variety of reasons, and they might feel that they are the wrong color, they are, you know, the wrong race, they are from the wrong side of the tracks as far as health and poverty is concerned and stuff like this, or there might be issues to do with disability, sexuality, all sorts of things at which they might feel that life has disadvantaged them. And you can carry a sense of victimhood, injustice, and so forth. Now, how does Buddhism deal with this? Really, to have a deep acceptance of the fact that this is how it is. This is how I feel. I feel that that life is treating me unjustly. So I look at it from and I make peace with the fact that I feel that life is unfair to me. Okay, so and by making peace with it, I come to a degree of peace. Now, many people suggest, oh, I've got to do something about it. In other words, I have to stand up for my rights. I've got to be politically active. I have to put my head above the parapet. I have to do various things. That actually is a separate conversation. So the key thing is to make peace with the way things are, the status quo, make peace with that. Whether you take action or whether you become active in a particular sphere or social cause, that is a separate conversation. So I just like to say that, and this is my view. This may not be the view of somebody else that also claims to be a Buddhist psychotherapist or something like this. Now, I'll be talking about meditation and mindfulness later on in this talk, so I won't touch upon it now. And for anybody, if anything I've said has particularly, you think it's been particularly helpful, I've written this book, 2014, Buddhist Teachings, that contains the quintessential essence of everything I've said here, The Art of Letting Go. And I've also reworked much of this material on Buddhist psychotherapy in my main book on mental health. So it's there for anybody to read. But this is my take on it. And everybody's take on it is their take on it. Now, before I end this topic, I'd like to refer to the title of a book I came across. And that was called Why is the Dalai Lama Always Smiling? By somebody called Lama Tsomo. And that's a very good title, actually. Why is the Dalai Lama always smiling? And the reason is that it's not because his life is easy, but something has allowed him to smile, to be of good cheer, and to smile in the face of continued troubles and anxieties, as it were. So, and that is actually embodies what Buddhist psychotherapy or the Buddhist life is about. Its ability, the ability to be of good cheer and to smile in all circumstances. Right, the next topic is transpersonal psychotherapy. Now, this is a term that was coined by Carl Jung, the word trans meaning beyond, and personal, meaning the person, so it refers to psychotherapy that takes in materials that are, as it were, beyond the person. Now, all religious philosophies and all different kinds of esoteric paths are included in this particular format. So, all the great religions of the world and all the great spiritual paths have certain inner development traditions, you know, steps of growth and whatnot, and so all therapies that take these kinds of teachings as a foundation come under this particular form of transpersonal psychotherapy. So you get ideas about karma, soul, God, self, reincarnation, heaven, hell, the afterlife, spirit, etc., etc. Now, it's quite important to understand transpersonal psychotherapy from the Maslow's hierarchy of needs theory. Now, we know that the Maslow's is a seven scale, like a pyramid, And once one has one's basic needs met and security, protection, shelter met, the next stage is giving and receiving of love and affection. So these are really about very ordinary life. And let's look at the other four things, and they are: the fourth stage is respect for others and also experiencing self-esteem. The fifth is curiosity and the search for knowledge. The sixth is experiencing beauty, order, and symmetry. And the seventh stage, called self-actualization, is, as it were, the peak and finding the meaning of one's personal life, I think. That's what it would mean. So transpersonal psychotherapy really refers to the upper stages of the Maslow hierarchy of needs theory. And there are no two transpersonal psychotherapists that are alike. So you can consider that all forms of therapy where you have a student and a spiritual teacher that is guiding them in their life, that is a form of spiritual therapy. Obviously, you need to have a complete match between the client and therapist. For instance, if you are a Christian, then you need a Christian counselor and who might interpret your experience in terms of maybe the Bible. One of the best examples of transpersonal psychotherapies is the therapy based on the Jewish system called the Kabbalah, things like this. So, and there's a chapter of it in my book. Okay, let's move on to healing and Reiki. Now, this is a subject I personally know a lot about, and I've had a lot of personal experience, and I recommend it very much. To understand healing and Reiki, one has to look at the body as having a kind of biofield around it. So around all living things, and human beings in particular, there's a kind of an aura of energy that radiates from the body, probably extending about 6 inches outside the body, where all one's kind of psychic energies are also held. Now this aura or this biofield contains a lot of your psychic stuff and stuff that goes on a subtle level. Now, energy practitioners or Reiki practitioners and healers, etc., are sensitive people who have an ability to, as it were, read this energy or read this energy field, often connect with it, detect often where disease might be or where the energies are low, and often make adjustments or give healing to the person. Now, it is not their personal energy that they give, but it's believed that there is a kind of universal energy which can be channeled into a person's energy field through the agency of a sensitive person or healer. Now, unlike the other therapies, healing is not a talking therapy, so the therapy does not involve speaking to the healer beyond the most basic things. And essentially, generally speaking, a person will lie down on something like a massage couch, be made comfortable, and the healer will often start to connect with the person, and using usually hand gestures and often with the agreement of the client, put their hands on certain parts of their body, their feet, their knees, their belly, their back, and so forth, and as it were transfer energy or healing. And often if there is a particular part of the body that appears to be hurting, like if you've hurt your knee, then the healer will direct healing energies to the knee area, things of this sort. Now, I personally have had a lot of experience with healers and healing, and I can complete, and I thoroughly recommend it. And people going through periods of depression, anxiety, stress, PTSD, if people are low in energy, tired all the time, they will benefit from seeing a healer, I'm very certain. And I go often, not because anything's wrong with me, but every time I have a healing, I feel a lot better. And this is palpable. So it's now it's quite easy to find healers if you live in Britain, because all spiritualist churches offer healing as part of their ministry. And this is free of charge. And people simply put a little donation in the box or something like this. Or one can actually kind of pay and see a Reiki healer or a healer that practices privately. And some healers that have a very good reputation often have quite a clientele. And I certainly recommend it. And there's a chapter in my book about it. I now want to go on to the whole topic of hypnotherapy. Now, to understand the concepts behind hypnotherapy, it's helpful to imagine the ideas of conscious and subconscious. So, if you're for instance traveling by plane over an ocean, and maybe you come to a group of islands sitting out there in the ocean. Now, obviously, the above water that you see is the top of the island, right? But that island must have be the top of a kind of mountain that, as it were, sits on the seabed. So that's the kind of diagram. So you've got the seabed here, you've got a mountain coming out of the seabed, and then the top part, which is shaded green here, is the part that you see. And this is representative of the life we know. So the concept of subconscious first came about with Sigmund Freud, like, 120 years ago. And since then it has stuck. And different concepts and ways of working of the subconscious have evolved. So the idea is that underneath what is seen or conscious, there are whole levels of subconscious activity. And as we grow through life, through, as it were, nature and nurture, people develop certain kinds of behaviors, complexes, and things like this. It might be superiority complexes, inferiority complexes, and people, as it were, develop kinds of programs that sit at the subconscious level and play themselves out in the way they behave in life. Now, it's quite important to understand that when people react to other people, something inside them, something under the surface in them responds to something under the surface in other people. So things like body language and the kind of vibes people give out, are the kind of vibes that other people perceive on a subconscious level. So a lot of human communication is actually on a subconscious level. So this is actually a very important topic. Now, if you look at this so-called mountain of subconscious material, the part that is below fairly below the waterline. That is the more superficial subconscious level on which a lot of activity goes on, and you get whole fields of knowledge called clinical hypnotherapy and hypnotherapy in general that claim to understand people's inner programming under the surface and make adjustments and help them. For example, if you have a depression and anxiety or a stress due to a kind of belief that is rooted in the subconscious, then obviously it is possible for a hypnotherapist to possibly, assuming that they can do it, to alter something in the subconscious and assist in the removal of such a belief, and thus they are able to help the person with anxiety and so forth. So that's one thing. There's a great deal in the public domain on hypnotherapy, and for any person listening to this that is interested in this subject, I would suggest that they Google the name of Marissa Peer. Now, Marissa Peer is probably the world's best known public speaker on hypnotherapy, and she's and there are dozens of videos of her on the net, which anybody can listen to, her public talks and things like this. And one of the things about hypnotherapy, they really are able to sell their ideas and whatever. And she's it's a masterclass in communication listening to Marissa. So imagine, for an argument's sake, that people have certain subconscious issues, like some people, maybe because the way they were brought up or whatever, or they are kind of a doormat. So imagine that it's helpful to imagine that your subconscious tendencies, as it were, like on a t-shirt that you wear under the on top of yourself. And if it says doormat there, how do you think other people will treat you? They'll just walk all over you, because that's what you're telling them. I'm a doormat, walk all over me. So if somebody else has a victim, how will people that interact with them treat them? Well, they'll say, oh, poor you. So they don't un-victimize themselves. They actually, other people say, oh, poor thing, poor you. You know, I'm very sorry about this. But, you know, if somebody says, I have no confidence, and they go for a job, then that idea that they have no confidence may not get them the job that they want. Or if they are out for romance and they have got a sign on their t-shirt that says, I'm not really lovable, then it doesn't help. So there are blocks that people have that supposedly clinical hypnotherapists can understand and help them work through it. So, and you can see a lot about this, as I said, watching Marissa Peer on the net. And the other thing hypnotherapy is used for is actually to enhance performance. So people like sports, high level sportsmen, have to maintain a high degree of mental resilience to do their sport or to be successful in their sport. So also performers or public personalities and things like this, they are greatly helped by seeing hypnotherapists. So there are many hypnotherapists that work for celebrities, and this is a part where supposedly they help them enhance their performance. So that is the most superficial level of hypnotherapy. Now what, I don't know enough about it, but some things about it. What actually is deeply interesting to me is deep level hypnotherapy, and supposedly hypnotherapy that occurs at a much deeper level, on what I call a soul kind of level. I'm using that word soul descriptively. It's very low down. And so you get certain types of hypnotherapists that specialize in this. Now, people can supposedly be entranced, as it were, in after a preparation. And when hypnotherapists ask them specific questions, they can give you specific answers. And within the context of deep level hypnotherapy, you get something called past life regression therapy, and there is life between lives therapy. Okay, so these tell you the programming of the person on a very, very deep level, like what is the meaning of their life and things like this on a very deep level. Now, things like past life regression therapy is often a few people occasionally assume that it is an oriental thing because past lives is connected with oriental religions like Hinduism and Buddhism, for example, the term. But however, all these things are completely American therapies. Here are some of the very important people that have developed this therapy all in the last maybe 50 years. In the 1980s, there was Dr. Brian Weiss, MD, who was at one time the head of psychiatry at Mount Sinai Medical Institute, and he stumbled upon the concept of past lives during the course of his work. And he became very interested, and he retired from conventional medicine and spent the rest of his life studying it and wrote a number of best-selling books on the subject. So there's Dr. Brian Weiss. Now, in the 1990s, another American, he was a psychologist, Dr. Michael Newton, he kind of stumbled upon the idea that before people are actually born, they have a kind of, they develop a plan for the life they are going to lead when they come down on Earth. And he actually drew a very detailed map of what tends to happen before one is born, and how one, as it were, develops something called a pre-birth contract. And who are the other people involved in drawing this contract? This is perhaps beyond the scope of a talk like this, but people should read his books called Journey of Souls and Destiny of Souls to understand more about this. And also another very famous person in this field is Robert Schwartz, who wrote two books called Your Soul's Plan and Your Soul's Gift. And they are extraordinary works and which deal with specific issues that people have come up with. Now, obviously, you need to read a little bit about them to get a gist of their thing. But I think, certainly to me, this is very interesting, and I've read. And one of the key things about deep level hypnotherapy, as I have described, is that not only is it all American, it is pretty much all American. It is only about 50 years old in total, and all the therapy sessions are actually recorded on tape. So it's not the hypnotherapist's idea, because when the person goes into trance, a tape recorder is set, and both the questions and answers are recorded and played back to the client at a later stage, you see. And so this is what you said under hypnosis. And can you relate to that? Now, for many people that do go through this process of deep level hypnosis, they find that often if they have an issue, they have often experienced dramatic cures. It is relevant, because these kinds of things can often lead to dramatic cures of what what has been troubling them, profound healing and so forth. But it is not for everyone, and I invite you to delve into these topics more if you find yourself interested in them.